Good morning.
The context in which the pastor has called me, I only appreciate it because I know that's what my mom had in mind when she named me that way. She had been a Christian for, I think, as many years as I possibly know. And it looks like Paul had made such a deep impression on her that she gave me that one. But she also named my other brothers, James, Joseph. It looks like Joseph was so impressive that she named two of my brothers Joseph. Because with the Kikuyu style of naming, if it happens that your name is Ann and your husband's mother is Ann, you will be Ann and your daughter will be Ann. But the Paul one, I think, is the impression that the Apostle Paul had made on my mother. And also her expression of faith that maybe one day we will know the Lord and follow him. So in that context then I accept it, otherwise not in that I'm anywhere near Paul. It's good to be here this morning, and I happened to yesterday read devotion number 40. I don't know who has reached there yet. Looks like some people maybe one step behind. Is there anyone else who has reached number 40? Oh yeah, I can see someone else reached number 40. And that made me stop and ask myself, what has that been about? And a lot of things crossed my mind. And so when we were asked this morning whether the faith has increased since last time, I did tell Pastor whether it had increased or not. But now I have a chance to say, there are things that I have relooked at through this process that have made me very glad that you went through this process, through this campaign. Just the reminder of how much God is in control, but also how much God is there. Just that, God is there. And by that I mean, if I had thought that there was a way of ordering my life into success that is besides God, then I have been reminded that actually the true of the best of my life, the best of my life, is really based on how I'm going to closely order my life according to these principles. So I'm glad that you went through this campaign, and I hope that you've also had such encounters for yourself that you can say during that campaign, some things got aligned. Some things became personalized to me. When I say them, I now say them not as the Bible says only, but as I now know because of the way God has worked. And one of the things that is probably one of the biggest things that has occurred to me, if I may start there, was I remembered how leaving campus, I was like, God, how did I even make it through campus? It's amazing, isn't it? And so I had this idea that, what if I take the other chance of my life to just go out and serve the Lord? And I literally went, the first 10 years of my life, I went out and did ministry as a volunteer. And it got to a point where, you know, got a family and, you know, at times families don't live on faith only. They need bread. And so I had to transition from what I was doing, and I started working. And God reminded me how he has made it such that there is literally no time I stayed without work to do. I work in a situation where you do things for 1, 2, 3 years, then it ends. But literally God has joined them, so that it has been a continuity that I have never actually had to sit back and think, what do I do? And that reminded me of the faithfulness of this God, and of the fact that even though when I was leaving what I was doing then, I told myself, I know, even though I've done this, God is not a debtor to any man, so I do not have any expectation that God is going to work so that I will never have to lack just because I started my life that way. I was very clear that God is not a debtor to any man. But to see him following through his promise as though it's a letter to me, that has been amazing. And during this campaign, I have been reminded of that, that these principles that we are learning, that this is what works, I have seen it in my life. And not because of effort, but because God just stood by his word and did it. And that has meant a lot to me as I think about this daring faith. Because a lot of the things we have said are actually, what I would say, countercultural. They are even counterintuitive. When you think of how things are supposed to work, according to normal human thinking, and then you compare them the way, with the way scripture says things are supposed to work, a lot of it is actually counterintuitive. But during this campaign, I've been reminded to let that be the basis. The fact that I believe in God and God has said it, because time and time again, I have seen it work in my life. And so as I stand here, I stand very glad that we went through this campaign. And so today, we come to our session where we are looking at daring to be generous. Daring to be generous as one of the tenets of daring faith. And I'll begin with an introduction by just setting the context in which we are talking about daring to be generous. And the reason why the context is important is because we are in a society where this term, generosity and giving and seed, have been spoken of in contexts where the person speaking has very clear ideas about how they are going to be benefited if you only respond to that scripture. And maybe it's for tweeters that today it's not the pastor speaking here, even though the pastor reminds us that it's not the reason why he preaches this. Because that context has made the preaching on giving become very muddy. And in fact, whenever I hear somebody starts preaching on this, I sit tight, because quite often it's very connected with their own livelihood. It is usually because their ambition to have their kids getting the best of education is very much linked with how well they preach this message. That's not the context we are speaking about this today. Rather, the context we are speaking about it scripturally is that if you want your life to be truly blessed, there are three things you need to build your life on. And one of them is generosity. That is contributing to God's work and also sharing with others what you have. That's the context in which we are talking about this term, generosity. And scripture over and over talks about the connection between how much you end up having and how much that you give. And so, building your life on these tenets does create the blessed life that really anyone would want to wish for. The second thing is holiness. So generosity, holiness, that is turning from doing what God hates. I look for the simplest ways of explaining what I mean by holiness. Turning away, repenting, changing direction from doing things that God doesn't like and starting to do only what God likes. And secondly, in holiness, is dealing with men righteously. How you deal with people. Holiness. And number three, humility. That is fearing God, being humble before God, but also towards human being, putting others first. That's the context in which I use this word, humility. And so, generosity, holiness, and humility are key things in aligning your life as a Christian to live the best life you can live. The life that you are designed by God to live. If you align yourself in these three ways, then you will most likely end up being able to achieve it. This is 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, that tells us that this is what the difference is between living according to the world and living in accordance to God's will. In these three areas, where it says that living according to the world is living in greed, in lust, and in pride. And those three are the opposites of generosity, holiness, and humility. And so if you've ever wanted to think about how your life as a Christian would all be summed up in three simple words. It would be this: generosity, because that way you overcome greed; holiness, because that way you overcome lust; and humility, because that way you overcome pride. And so it's as one of these three that we talk about generosity today. That's the context, that we are not talking about it because of how much benefit this would bring to the person speaking to you, but because it's one of the three main pillars of living a blessed life. And so we'll be talking about generosity in that context. But also, I dare mention the contemporary context in which we are living in is a context where God has called us together as a small church. And I say a small church knowing that this is only for a time, because with time, we will no longer use that description for our church. But what does it mean for us to be in a small church? It means that each one of us, whatever we bring, actually is extremely beneficial. Whoever you are, whatever you come as, whatever you bring is extremely useful, because we are in a small church where we need everyone, and we need everything you are, everything you can bring, and everything you can give to God. And so that's a contemporary context, that indeed these three things, generosity, holiness, and humility, are needed for your life, but also we have come together as a congregation that would greatly benefit if all of us put together what we have, your talent, your ability, the things you are very good at, and then we all use those to build our growing church. And I see this put out by Paul in the main scripture that we are going to be referring to today. That is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10 to 13. And I want to read it for you, because I want to explain that how we have come to be the congregation we are is by design. And if we take advantage of that reality and give of ourselves what we have, then we are going to actually go, we are going to grow, we are going to rise up, and we will be the light that we desire to be for this area that God has called us to. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. It says this, and these are scriptures that we have read over and over during this campaign. Now, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed, and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way, so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and in everyone and with everyone else. These words of Paul to the Corinthians highlight some things that I think are very relevant to us. When he says that you will be made rich in every way, verse 11, you will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. This I see being relevant to us in this way, that as a congregation, everything that we need, every aspect of ministry that needs to happen, there is somebody God has brought amidst us to be able to supply that kind of ministry. And that's why it says that you will be made rich in every way, so that in all occasions, you can be generous. When it's an occasion for us to have a family fun day, there are people here who are blessed with being able to mobilize people's energies to have fun in a family setting. When it is time we need individual ministry, when it is time we need people hosted in homes, there are people who have been enriched in that way. The challenge is actually whether we will remember to be generous in every occasion. By every occasion here, it is pointing to the different types when different aspects of ministry will be needed.
that you may never be the usher, you may never be the singer, you may never be the preacher, but there are aspects of ministry that God has made this congregation rich by bringing you, if only you remember to be generous at the point where it is needed. So what does that mean? It means that when we are thinking about generosity, it also points to us to think about, what is it that God has given me in abundance? What is that I feel lightness when I am doing for the people of God or for other people? And then you ask yourself, what are those occasions where that is called upon in the church? And how can I step up and be able to offer that? That's the benefit we have by being part of this growing congregation. That there will be opportunities that you can step up and stand in and be the one to be counted. And just think about it. There are things that you have much more than everyone in this congregation. There are things that you can do much better than most people in this congregation. So when it is about being generous in all occasions, we are calling upon that. We want to draw you out of just being able to sit in church into thinking, what is it that I have that the Lord has put in me? And when it is needed, how do I quickly rise up and provide it? There are times we need to be happy and to laugh. Who are those who are comedians among us? God has been generous to us that way. But there are people here, they stand here, and just by standing, we start cracking up. Shall we remember to be generous in all occasions? When your occasion comes, will you be challenged to remember to rise up to the occasion at that time? So when we talk about generosity, we are talking about the breadth of it, the opportunities we have. There are people here who are administrators, where when we have a function, they'll be able to think through all the aspects of what that needs to be done. Will you remember to step up? When that call is made, and you feel like something has happened in you, and you're like, what? And probably that's what you are good at. Will you remember to be generous? God has given us abundance so that we can be generous in all occasions. And I think that's also a reality in a small church. When you are in a big church, at times it's hard because there are so many people. And every little call has people crowding in. But in a small church, we literally need every one of us, our generosity in every occasion. I like that occasion of reciting the six verses that I tried very hard, but they kept jumbling up in my mind. But there is somebody who even remembers by which version. And she was actually generous on this occasion. Won't you agree?
Yes.
That's what it means. God has supplied us with everything so that we can be generous in all occasions. There is somebody prepared for every occasion. Please remember to rise up. And so, daring to be generous. Why is it that we would want to bring out this? Why is it that this is something that we want to talk about? There are many, many, many reasons. And we are going to go through a number of them and just encourage ourselves that this is actually a good thing that we are being called into. Because, you know, generosity, the first thing it does is when you are generous, you honor God. Our generosity honors God. We have read in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 13, that you will be glorifying God through your generous gifts. When we are generous, we glorify God. And just reading some of the thoughts that Rick Warren has talked about, there's this story that he mentioned that is also very real to us. Those of us who are children, you know what happens when you understand your kid and you go and buy them that thing that they really, really, really like. Some of them is a packet of chips. Some of them is maybe some sweets. You go out and you decide to really be nice to them and you buy them those chips. And occasionally, especially when they are younger, you try to kuangalia chumvi, you know, you got your kid those chips and unataka kuangalia kama iko na chumvi.
And so you are like, eh, ebuni, ebuni yonje. And quite often what happens? The kid? No, you will not. And when we are talking about generosity, especially when it is God calling on us to be generous, we are in that kind of situation where we have got our favorite. We, those chips, that kid has got those chips. And then God is saying, hebu nionje nisikie vile zinaonja. Because, you know, as we talk about generosity, there is nowhere where I see you being told, take everything, go give it away, and stay without. But quite often, that's exactly what you do. And I am talking about this being one of those who realizes that actually, quite often, when God has tried to dip his hand and take just one finger of chips, I am very quickly to fold the basket. And so we are talking about generosity towards the God who has given us everything. And now he is seeking for us to give back because it brings honor to his name. The context in which Paul was talking about this is a situation where there were people who are going through, who are being ravaged by famine. But in other places there was food. And so these Christians actually gave. They took a lot of offerings and they just sent that food to those who are needy. In other occasions, Paul needed to travel and they begged him, Paul, let's make a collection for you so that you can go and be able to travel and be okay as you go around. Literally, that act of giving because other people were hungry, that act of giving because the ministry of Paul needed to go ahead, Paul is saying here that it glorifies God when the Corinthians give. And so we seek to be generous because it honors God. Number two, when we are generous, that draws us close to God. We read in Matthew that in Jesus' understanding, and I like when it is Jesus' opinion, because that opinion is not like the opinions that we hear these days in TV. You can rely on it. Jesus said that where your treasure is, your heart also will be. I think we have mentioned that scripture over and over here during this campaign. What does that mean? If you keep your treasure with God, then your heart will also be there, and then you will draw closer to God. Because then your heart will be where your treasure is. And we have learned over and over that how to keep your treasure with God is simply through giving, through being generous. And so if you want to draw close to God, then you do that when you are generous, because you are consciously giving away some of what you have, because you know you are storing it up with God and you are making up for yourself a treasure with God. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there also your heart shall be. So when we are generous, it gives us the avenue to draw close to God. That act of giving, it is mine. I could have used it, but I'm now giving it away to somebody else because consciously you want to store up for yourself a treasure in heaven. That is always a moment of you reflecting, of focusing on God, of remembering who God is to you, and that way you draw closer to God when you are being generous. Generosity also makes us more like Jesus. Because Jesus, when we think about what he did, he just simply gave himself for us. He was so generous that the Bible says, hardly would anyone give up himself for a righteous man. But Jesus gave up his life for us when we were still sinners. The supreme example of giving. He did not only just give us a bit of himself, but Jesus gave everything to us and for us. And so our generosity, when you do it, when you take what is yours and give it for God's work or give it to people, because you are doing it in honor of God, then you are becoming more like Jesus, the ultimate giver. And this is a calling for us to imitate Christ. And one of the ways of imitating Christ
is simply
by giving
and being generous. Who is that you interact with on a day-to-day basis? Would you want them to know that you are actually a follower of Jesus? One of the easiest ways is when you go out of your way and give them that 50 bob after they have done something for you that they are supposed to do anyway. And you choose to be generous with them. It will be much easier when they hear your name mentioned in connection with Christ for them to see, oh yeah, truly that's a good person. That person reflects the life of Jesus. Generosity makes us more like Jesus. And there are many, many, many reasons that I could almost call about us. The way we want our life to be, there are many reasons for us to want to be generous. Because generosity actually affects your life currently in a positive way. The Bible shows that. That one, in the struggle for materialism, what the Bible says is that you cannot love God and love money at the same time. The antidote for that, the antidote for the love of money, the antidote for materialism is actually generosity. So that you need to practice generosity in order to cure materialism. Because, you know, as you work hard, God will bless you with money. But it's so easy for you to be excited about what you are getting. And eventually you find yourself so much more concerned about what you are getting. And that is exactly what the love of money is. Materialism, that's what it is. And when you think about it, there are lots and lots, I would say, of preachers who you think about 10 or so years ago, they were doing amazing work. They were going for crusades and you have hundreds of thousands of people attending. Can you recall any? Yeah, you can mention them, right? And if you ask me what happened to them, some of them went on and wanted to become presidents of this country. Others took other callings. What exactly may have happened to them? Allow me to diagnose that what happened is that they went out and did great things for God and trusted God. But as God started pouring blessings to them, slowly their attention began to be drawn by the money that was coming to them. And as their attention is drawn to that, which happens almost always, I don't know whether you are doing a business that is on its upward trend. You know how it gets engaging. You know the beauty of making double what you made last time. You know how it feels when you can say, I am making 4 times more than last year or the year before. And how easily we can get carried away by that. And this challenge of materialism, of the love of money, which says that nobody, where the Bible says nobody can serve 2 masters. It is insidious. It catches up with you because it's usually a very slow creep. And if you are determined to be able to overcome this, the solution is right here, given with us. Be generous with what you are getting. Begin to compete between how fast it's coming and how more you can give. Because then that becomes the cure for materialism. So generosity is a cure for materialism. God has given us a way out so that we are without excuse when we get carried away by the love of money. We are without excuse because God has given us a way out. Be generous because you cannot serve both God and money. Again, we have over and over here read that as in 1 Timothy 6:17 to 19, that we command those who are rich in this current world to be generous, to be willing to share, so that they will get hold of the life that is truly life. If you want to escape that trap of the love of money, the solution has been given to us. It is to be generous, to give generously. But also as we read in 2 Corinthians, generosity demonstrate faith. Paul told the Corinthians that your giving proves the reality of the faith that you confess. When you say you are giving because of, then it goes beyond just saying
is one of the simple ways of putting actions into our faith. Faith without actions is dead. As a demonstration of our faith, we take what is rightfully ours in terms of the fact that God has already given the package to us. But then we say, because I know it came from you, when you reach out your hand, God, to pick some of it, I will not quickly cover the package of the gift. As a demonstration of our faith. That's what Paul was telling the Corinthians, that when you have given, the people that we are going to take these gifts to, when they hear that you gave because you had their suffering, and they are your brothers and sisters in Christ, they will confirm the veracity of your faith. And if you think about it, in the olden days, this was not a globalized world. People didn't know much about each other. Because then, people mostly only had covered a distance you could walk with your own feet. People only had news or new things that they could see with their eyes. That's only within the eye shot, or things they could hear with their ears. I know we live in a world that we take for granted that you can receive a call from somebody who is on the other side of the world. You can watch news and know what is happening in Vietnam. What these people are doing is that they were dealing with people they had never met. It's probably only Paul who had come and told them, there are other people who have also believed in this Christ like you. And then Paul is coming back, and he comes with packages and packages of food to bring to people who are ravaged by famine. And the first question they want to ask is, where did this come from? How did you manage to do this? And Paul tells them, there are other people who have believed in this Christ like you, who are not in the same situation, and they gave me these gifts to bring to you. Very different. In a world that was not as globalized as we are today, these are people who probably had never met. And so if Paul came and told them, there are other people who are believing in this Jesus, what would be the evidence? He comes loaded with gifts from them and tells them, actually, those people who have believed in Jesus, when they heard that you are in trouble, they contributed and they gave me this to bring to you. What better testimony could have been to those people to hear there are other people who have believed in Christ than to hear that actually they are bothered, they have considered to give of what they have so that the others can share. It's a remarkable thing in a world where you do not even know whether there are other people anywhere. It's only Paul who has come and told you there are other people who have believed in this Jesus. And then he comes and brings you goodies. He comes and brings you resources to meet very pressing needs given by other people who have believed in this Christ. Remarkable. So generosity demonstrates our faith. It was then, it does even today. Our giving shows the reality of our faith in God. Generosity reveals our character. When we are generous, it does show that what God has given us, we are able to release it. We are able to store it up as heavenly treasure. And therefore, that shows that we can be trusted with more. In Luke chapter 16, verse 11, Jesus said, who will trust you with more if you are not trustworthy with little? And the Bible says that if you are untrustworthy with little, nobody will trust you with more. How do you become trustworthy with the little you have? It's by sharing, by being able to give some of it, by being able to show that given more, you can actually give more. You know, it's natural or very human to think that I will give when I will have more. But the reality is no. God is not waiting for you to get more so that you give more. If anything, he is checking to see what you are doing for what you have right now, to see whether if he gave you more, you will be able to give more. I always get amazed that quite often, God decides that he will use human beings. There are people who have needs that God decides not to meet directly, but chooses to use human beings. And how I wish I can be a very effective tool, because God is such that he does not expect you to give and be left the worse off. If anything, he will also allow you to enjoy what he's given you. He will leave you the bigger portion for you to enjoy if only you remember
to be generous. Generosity reveals our character. Can we be trusted with little? And if we can, God has promised that indeed He will trust us with more. And this led me thinking about, really, why would God be so interested in us being generous? Especially knowing that He does not need anything that we have. He does not need the money in my pocket. He doesn't. If He wants to do what He needs to do, He will do it with or without it. And think about it. How many things is God doing without involving you and me? Many things. Many things. And so He is able to do it without me. So why is He interested that I be involved in this project of generosity? First, is that God loves a cheerful giver. And so my generosity, my being able to give, is going to attract God's favor and God's love on me. It's all about me. And that's amazing, because if you think that by being generous, others will benefit, here we are reminded that actually, because God loves a cheerful giver, this generosity that you show towards others, it attracts God's favor to you, to yourself. It's mostly about me. And that becomes amazing, because you would think that God is very interested in getting what is in your pocket. Actually, God is very interested with adding more. He loves a cheerful giver. Being loved by God. I remember when I was reading the next one, that generosity brings happiness. It occurred to me that blessedness, a blessed person, cannot but be a happy person. And God is interested in our generosity because it will bring happiness to us. The blessedness of God brings about happiness in our lives. And so when you think about it, you realize that because it's more blessed to give than to receive, that the one who gives is more blessed. You know, humanly, you feel very nice when somebody has given you a good gift, right? It feels really nice. But again, counterintuitively, as faith is, it is actually more blessed. You will be happier when you are giving than when you are receiving. I don't know how often you experience that. The joy of giving, that generosity brings happiness in our lives. Generosity, number 9, and we are beginning to run out of time, expands our influence. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24. The world, I found this a very interesting translation. The world of the generous gets larger and larger, while the world of the stingy will get smaller and smaller. New International Version says, the generous gets more and more prosperous, while as the stingy ends up in poverty. Generosity will expand your influence. Just think about it. When you see people willing to die for someone, what has that got to be? It's always about what they receive from that person. And so when you are generous with what God has given you, you are able to exert your influence. You are able to influence more people. You are able to have a larger sphere of influence by what you give. And so generosity expands my influence. Generosity multiplies my money. This is probably the one I find most counterintuitive. When we think about it, how is money multiplied? If you ask any good accountant, any good entrepreneur, they will tell you money is multiplied. You know, the typical Kikuyu version is that a shiringi is molecular with another shiringi. You know? You use a shilling to look for the other shilling. What they do not tell you is that they mean that you hold on to it, and the more you have, the more you can find more with it. But scripture is actually very interesting, because it actually puts it the other way. A generous man will prosper. He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. This idea that a generous man prospers more, that the one who gives more is the one who ends up getting more, it is counterintuitive. Especially because we live in a situation where the more you richer you are, the harder you have to work to protect your wealth. Because you think about protecting it. But true riches comes when we are generous, because a generous man will prosper more, but a stingy will end up in poverty. Some of these scriptures, if you take them to heart, I find them very liberating, because then, do you want to prosper? Of course you want to. Do you want to get a bit more money like me? Of course you want to. What is God's foolproof formula? God's foolproof formula is that when you give away, your wealth gets multiplied. And not just that, what you have gets protected by God. One time I was talking with Pastor, and we were talking about, would you rather have a very good medical cover, or would you rather have very good health? Would you want to be richer in good health, or richer in a big, nice medical cover? And that's the difference it makes. When the Bible says that a generous man will prosper, some of the prosperity is just about the little you have not having holes. Because the Bible says, when you are stingy, even what you have, when you put it in your pocket, it's like your pockets have holes. Amazing. I find it amazing that actually the formula, again, is all laid before us. And the Bible says that generosity brings God's protection. You may have little, but when it is protected, it will go a long, long way. Psalms chapter 112, verse 5 to 9, I found it very interesting, because those verses actually talk about what will happen to someone when they are generous. That God will come to those who are generous and lend freely. I found it interesting that they will have no fear for bad news. A lot of the protectionism that we do over what we have is because we fear for when it will be attacked and taken away. But God says, for a generous man, they will have no fear for bad news. Because even the bad news, they will only be a setup for God to take them to the next level. Because God brings his protection. I found Psalms 112 very, very interesting. That the reflections of the writer there were that God will come close to those who are generous and lend freely. Not having to fear bad news. What would bad news be like? Just this past week, a colleague of mine, they woke up in the middle of the night. They were woken up by some people, and they were told, ulale hivo hivo, muendele hivo hivo, na msindue kichwa. And of course, you know, they ransacked the house. And when you hear such a story, what happens to you? If you are like me, kawaida human being, you begin to think, what if that were to happen to me? What would happen? How secure is my house? The fear for bad news. But God will come to those who are generous and lend freely. They will have no fear for bad news. Because you will not be afraid, because the Lord will protect what you have. And finally, generosity will be rewarded in heaven. I think we've read this scripture over and over and over, and I find it amazing that 1 Timothy chapter 6, it has a lot to do with this. And it reminds us that when you are generous and you share what you have, you will store up for yourself real treasure in heaven, and you will have life that is truly life. Our generosity, as we have said it again and again here, has a reward in heaven. We store up treasure in heaven through generosity. And that's the reason why God is interested with us being generous. In fact, somebody talks about how often the admonition to give in scripture is repeated probably than most other things, because of the interest God has. The connection between what is in your pocket and how you will live in eternity is all drawn out there. That when you are generous and you share, you'll be storing up for yourself treasure in heaven, and you will, through giving what you have, be able to have life that is truly life. Brothers and sisters, I say the context why we need to learn to be generous is not because somebody is waiting somewhere to benefit. It is because it is your pathway for all these benefits that the Lord has enlisted in this world. And so as we think about daring faith, let it be that part of our daring is about being more generous. Let us dare to be generous. Let's take some time and think about what we've been talking in prayer before the Lord. What do you hear when you hear this call to be generous? Do you feel a sense of being set free? Do you feel a sense of relief? Or do you feel contradictions within yourself? This is an area where God invites us to test Him. He invites us to give and then to test and see whether He will not defeat us. He will not outgive us. He invites us to give and then to see whether He is not able to give way more than we can contain. What is it that you hear? That you hear this invitation of daring to be generous? What challenge is God putting in your heart? What ways are those who will be around you are going to experience? What ways will they experience God? Will they see the evidence of your faith through your giving? In what way will this church see the confirmation of your faith through your giving? What is it that the Lord will say to you at this time? Lord, we acknowledge that it is clear in your word. In this world, though people have their ways of increasing their wealth, those who trust you are able to increase their wealth because of your blessing upon them. And this is unlocked when we freely give. You seek our faithfulness and our trustworthiness with the little that you've given to us now, so that you can trust us with more. You say in your word that a generous man prospers. And we do know that in all our hearts, we wake up early, we work hard, because we want to prosper. But here, you present to us the true ingredient that will bring prosperity to us. That Lord, when we go out and we get what we get, if we are willing to share it, if we are willing to give it for your work, and for the people in need around us, then we will have more. Lord, we thank you that the way to prosper by you is not a difficult thing. And we all can do it wherever we are. We all can do it with whatever we have. May you work in us, O God, so that we will have benefited from having listened to this sermon today. May you stir in us the willingness to respond by being generous, by giving generously. And through that generosity, Lord, you will continue to be glorified, and we will continue to prosper more. Your word tells us that if we do this, then we can only rise higher and higher. So help us, Lord. Help us to take that initial step, which is a step of faith, as we are reminded that faith is giving even what we do not have. Help us to take that initial step, every one of them. And those who have already begun in this journey, Lord, may you encourage them by opening their eyes to the ways that you've blessed them, the ways that you've protected what you've given to them, the way, Lord, that they do not need to fear for bad news, because God, you have come close to them. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us this way. So we will not be afraid. We will not fear lack, because God, You will not allow us to lack when we have done what your word has said. So Lord, we thanksgiving, we come to you and pray that you help us to truly, truly be generous for the sake of the work that you are doing in our midst, and also for the sake of the people around us. May we be known to be people who are generous wherever we are, whatever we are.